And so we were like, what's the worst microphone you've got in the building? He like went out and asked around and he came back with this thing. And so we used it for Kelis.
Yeah, so we used it on Kelis. Yeah, but she was laughing her head off because we were saying that all that stuff in front of her. It's Kelis, everyone. How are we doing today, Kelis?
Hi.
Are you well?
I am. I love your green couch. That's fabulous.
Thank you. Yeah. I look a bit stretched for some reason today. I look vertically stretched. I don't know why.
You do, actually.
Really stretched?
Yeah.
Is it an emotional thing? You guys
look great. I've been boxed in today. I feel a little bit boxed in. That's all it is. Yeah, I've got the green couch. We've got a pink fluffy rug here. This is basically my manager's house in LA, and Howard's in London. So we're...
Oh, nice.
Yeah, we're coming from all around the world today.
Amazing.
How have you been? Please?
I'm down, like, I'm south of LA. In Southern California, like in wine country down here.
So nice. I saw you were cooking up vegan enchiladas recently.
Empanadas, yes.
Empanadas. Oh, delicious. I think vegan Mexican food is the best type of food done vegan.
Well, it is pretty good, yeah. If you minus all the manteca, all the lard, yes. Like, yeah. But these were Colombian empanadas, so different than Mexican.
I see.
Very nice. A couple other conversation, guys.
Right. Got it. Well, so listen.
We need to get up to date on our South American and Mexican food.
Yes.
I'll help. Okay.
Yeah, perfect. Thanks.
So listen, today, right now, basically, we are live in front of how many people we got here? Like 1,000 people. And we do this like every week and we break down the songs that we've been making over the last, a year or two. And today we're going to do Watch Your Step. And nice. So yeah, we thought it'd be nice to get you on before, have a chat about the day, maybe go through like the meaning a little bit. So yeah, I mean, any memories come to mind for you? For me, it was a really fun, enjoyable, lighthearted day.
It was a really harder day and it was easy, which I think is always, we've talked about that before. It was easy. It wasn't stressed or like forced, which is always the best way. Like that's the only way I want to work.
Yeah.
What was cool for me about it was like, we're expecting, when you work with Americans, we kind of expect them not to know about UK garage that much. Like, it was never that big out there, right? But you just knew everything immediately.
Well, I mean, I'm in London so often. I'm probably there more than I'm anywhere else at this point.
Yeah.
I'm there more even than I'm in LA now. So
really, that was one of my favorite memories of the session, was where I was listing a few like local pubs near my house and you were like, oh yeah, I know that one. I lived there for 10 years. I was like, what? Kelis goes to my local pub for pints? Okay, cool. So we recorded and wrote all of Watch Your Step in like a day. At the Capitol Tower in LA, which is where we wrote a lot of the album. Actually, we had some really good energy there, good vibes this year or last year. And my memory was you just kind of turned up in the morning and we started talking about house music and like old breakbeat and 90s raves.
Well, I think that's kind of how. Well, the thing too, just to kind of, I mean, I think that for me, like even going there that day, because I don't record there that often. I've been there before, but I feel like it's such an iconic place, right? Like so much amazing music has been made in that building. And so like, I think for me, that's significant just because I feel like when you walk in, you feel it, you see all these photos of like all these really legendary musicians and artists. And so that's really open to just be able to do the collaboration there, I thought was really cool. And then we started talking about music and I'm a 90s, like, that's when I had my teen years. So like the 90s are super fun. And like, I was just thinking about breakbeats and being in New York. And then like, I felt, it feels like my memory of it is that like this all happened within like 2 hours. It felt like very short period of time. Like we just definitely were like, oh yeah, breakbeat. And then it was just like, that's it. So
yeah, it definitely fitted our idea for the whole record, was that flow of like immediate idea. Like if it's the one, it shouldn't be difficult. And if it's not, like, we'll write something else, because the whole record for us was about that, getting the initial idea out as quick as possible, making it an enjoyable, fun day, not one of those tunes that has like 30 versions, 5 masters.
You're so right. I feel like, I think too, like maybe it's just like this season I'm at in my writing now and like my life, I just feel like, yeah, like come out, like it should write, I don't know if you guys ever say it like this, but we always say like a song that writes itself, like it kind of just, you don't have to it seems like it was always there. Like it kind of just writes itself basically. Like, and it sort of felt like that. Like it shouldn't, I don't want to be sitting there thinking about like, do I change it to a the or an and, or do I, you know, yeah. like I've had moments where I'm like, I'm writing and like every little thing, and it, you know, becomes sort of arduous. Whereas I think like other times it just sort of flows out and it feels really genuine and natural. And those are the ones that kind of become the moments and the markers, I think, for me in my musical life.
For sure. I remember you saying when we were writing the lyrics towards the end, you were talking about how you were like reminded of being in those clubs back in the day. I was going to ask you if you remember where any of those clubs were, like what ones were you going to?
Oh my gosh, so many. I mean, like I was going to clubs before I was supposed to, obviously, like so many of us.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
You know, I mean, especially like in New York, like New York in the 90s was so fun.
So do you guys want to talk a little bit about the concept then and how you guys, because for me, it was just, I was in my laptop doing my beat making thing, like lost in the corner. And then you guys were on the couch writing away.
Yeah, sure. I feel like it came mainly from that breakbeat, right?
Yeah,
it was like, it started with that.
It was really just the vibe. And I think like, because the beat felt so good, we wanted to keep it simple, but make it something that you can kind of sing to, but like, you know, the old dance beat records weren't super wordy and like, you know, it's supposed to be fun and light and kind of like to the point. So that for me was the inspiration really.
Yeah, for sure. I remember one of my favorite parts about the song is when we got that idea of when you're like in your own space and then you see something like, and you're not worrying about anyone else, right? You're just kind of there for you.
Even then.
yeah.
Realize. We're like, I need 6 feet around me, please. Thank you.
Yeah. clear the room. But then like there's that moment sometimes when you clock that someone else is in that same zone.
Right.
And then you kind of, you merge bubbles, right? Like your 6 feet becomes their 6 feet. And it's this nice moment, right? That was my favorite aspect of the song, because I thought like, other than just being like, you know, yeah, I love breakbeat, that added like a bit more of a unique element to the song, which I really liked.
I think so too. No, the whole thing I think feels really good. And every time I hear it now, it's like, it feels like, and I think we could use that.
Yeah, definitely. I think for some people, it's probably taken on a new meaning, especially that line, I like to dance like I'm alone in the room. It's like, well, there's been a lot of that this year.
Yeah.
And it's like, if that's the only way I can get out, I'm like,
yeah, exactly. It's becoming like a TikTok thing. I'm surprised no one on TikTok's like taken that lyric and done a dance to it or something. Anyone watching right now who's good at TikTok, because I don't know what the hell it is, do that.
Yeah.
So are you writing much music at the moment? How are you balancing your kind of food career with music? Is that happening?
Like not really right now. I've sort of been, I think, yeah, really the year just started, like I was on tour and this year just kind of threw me all off, I think, like, honestly, like I was on the road and I was supposed to be on the road for 6 months. And so like coming home was, I mean, it's worked out, like I've been happy to be here, but I think really just like between that and then I had a baby. So it's just been like a lot of, yeah, a lot of other stuff happening.
A lot of grown up stuff.
Yeah, a lot of grown up stuff. So I had a baby and then like.
Congratulations.
Thanks. So we're on the farm and like just loving it out here. And it's actually given me time to like kind of get this aspect of my life sort of moving. But I was writing a lot like right before like all this stuff happened. So I've kind of been like mulling over that stuff and sort of I recently started re-listening and kind of like seeing if I'm in the same mental space, you know?
What are you growing on the farm? What's in season at the moment?
Oh, well, we just harvested a bunch of pumpkins.
Nice.
We harvested peppers. We've got peppers growing. I have lemongrass that we got to figure out what's going on with that. But I do have lemongrass for growing. We have like some like bok choy and some like cool like.
I love it. I love that you both just have loads of produce at the moment. I'm just talking to two farmers, yeah. Really. That's what I'm doing.
Are you farming too?
Yeah, all the same stuff you just said, minus the chilies. Yeah.
Oh no.
Because it's exactly hot. The same. Oh, yeah, no. I don't think you can do it here, like not in the winter anyway. But yeah, the pumpkins were good this year.
We're here, and so like the sun, we had like habaneros and we had habaneros, jalapenos, serranos. The chickens ate all of our, we had bell peppers, but they demolished them. So.
Me too. My chickens eat everything that I try and grow.
First, they ate everything. They ate, yeah.
What, even the spicy stuff? They're like, they just take it.
You know what's funny though? I didn't realize this, but apparently, I figured this out the hard way. Birds like spicy stuff. Like birds.
Maybe they like, don't have the receptors to like feel it or something.
Love them, so they ate
you
all.
You know what? I got a good tip the other day, which is that you can get, if you get ducks, they don't eat any of the food. They just eat the slugs.
Right. That's true. Yeah. But the ducks is ducks. They're gross. They like.
they kind of stink as well.
You know, like a pond or like a lake or something.
Yeah. Yeah. Listen, I'm going to try out ducks and I'll let you know how it goes.
You love ducks. I would love some ducks. Yeah.
All right. I think that's it. I think we're going to break down the song now. Thanks so much for doing this, Kelis.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Totally easy. I'm like, love it. Thank you, guys.
I can't wait till all this crap is over and we can get together and eat some of your delicious produce.
That would be good. And tell me how the ducks go, because I'm really genuinely like that.
I'll let you know. I'll let you know. I never thought I'd have that conversation with you.
Yeah.
Things change, man.
Talking to Kelis about ducks.
Yeah. They have ducks. Yeah. Love right now.
Yeah, me too.
Love it. All right. Thank you guys. Thanks so much, Kelis. You have a lovely day.
Bye. Thanks, Kelis.
So we got a 909 ride, just my doing money. 16ths, and some what sounds like 909 hi-hats. But they're all being sidechained really heavily. Yeah, that's so just full 909 vibes. I'm just using, like, I even used a picture of a 909 because I was so sure this was going to be a 909, this battery. So that's that. Moving down, we've got some Dilla. Yeah, it's probably claps and snares. Yeah, there you go. Classic Dilla vibes. And we've got some more snares here. So these are just, I've got so many snare samples over the years. I don't know what they are, where they're from. But that's them. So three snares layered up here, or two, then three. Layered that up with the Dilla claps and you get this. So my favorite thing about that is how the Dilla clap is coming in early and creating like a flam. You know, it's going ba, ka-ba, ba, ka-ba. So yeah, for me, that's just really satisfying, especially when you combine it with the breakbeat stuff. Yeah, that clap is just so ahead of the beat and so early, but it just makes it sound like a very natural human hand clap, you know, that wouldn't be in time perfectly. Got some cool reverse stuff going on there. I think that's all in Ableton. You can see here, I've just chopped and skewed the audio. Sounds powerful. A few hi-hats to go. What kind of hi-hats are we doing here? Garage hats, it says. So some old school garage samples. Ah, there you go. That's just one really simple downbeat hi-hat or offbeat hi-hat. Three sounds. Like a cabasa on the top. More of like a tappy hi-hat there. And then whatever you want to call that, another hi-hat. So yeah, not much like in terms of rhythmic stuff going on. You know, if you take the breakbeat out, it's pretty, you know, straight 4-4 beat. But, you know, with the addition of all of those breakbeats that we started with, it sounds super busy. I think my favorite bit about it is the tom or the drum in the background going dum 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 dum. So, yeah. And then a couple of shakers and some noise sweeps, and that's it. Yeah, shakers, noise sweep. That shaker's probably just something I got off Splice. I like Splice for easy percussion loops like that. I like the look of this track, Howard, Extra Cow. There it is.
Oh, that's a sneaky cowbell.
That is sneaky, isn't it? Let's hear that with the context of the whole drums. Yeah, it's just tiny in the right-hand speaker, just adding a little bit more. Ding, 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 ding. Love it. Cool. That is the drums. There's a few like sweepy build-up things here from the Monotribe. But yeah, that is pretty much all the drums. Howard, onto the chords. Anything you want to say about that?
Yeah, play them.
play them, just play the chords.
Yeah, that's what I have to say.
That's it.
Yeah, exactly. It's very simple, that.
It's pretty simple. There's not much to say, is it?
It's actually one chord with two inversions, I think.
Oh, God, yeah, so, it is. It's actually just B minor the entire time, and then, like, with the ninth or seventh on top or whatever it is. That's hilarious.
Yeah. So there you go. But, yeah, because of the bass changing, it does kind of make it into two chords. Boom, 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 boom.
Yeah.
Boom, boom, boom. Yeah, boom, boom, boom. So... this chord, that chord. Yeah. Definitely not the fanciest chords, but they get the job done with that bass line.
I think, yeah, you made the best bass line ever, and you were like, we don't need the chords to get in the way of this. Let's just let
well,
the
that's
bass
it.
Line
like,
do the
we
talk.
Didn't have chords when we wrote the song. We were just writing to the bass line, and then we just thought for texture, we wanted some. So I just made those. But yeah, normally we write around the chords. So it's definitely different to normal, this one.
Cool. So we got four synths. All contributing towards these chords. The bulk of it, I think, is the Prophet and the Poly 6. But we'll start with the Juno. Juno's doing beeps. Oh, sorry. Turn the buses off. Here's the beeps. Tal Juno for this. Didn't need to redo it on a normal Juno. It's just a beep. But there's quite a lot of automation that happens with these throughout the song for build-ups and that kind of thing. You can see here. Especially with the release, gets just builds tension and, you know, that kind of thing. I think maybe some modulation happens. It goes really crazy in the breakdown section here. Yeah, bit of modulation and that sort of thing. That's the Juno side of things. The Arturia Prophet, that is doing this. Looks like I sort of drew on a preset to begin it. It's called Old Butt. I reckon we probably read that, Howard, and we were like, yeah, let's use Old Butt.
Sounds about right. Yeah.
Sounds about right. Yeah, both oscillators on. It's a lot of noise in this patch, as you can hear. Whoosh. Can really gives it grit. So that's kind of like a sweepy thing, using the filter a lot. And yeah, the attack is very long. So that's why it's doing that wham thing. Turn that down and it goes... yeah, so tweaked all that and made it sound the way we wanted. After that is the Poly 6. That is doing this. So, you know, they all kind of sound like a Juno, but because I, you know, each one's doing a different thing, I thought we better choose three different synths as well, just so they have slightly different characteristics. You know, they're all sawtooth, but they are kind of different, you know, different attack, different general feel. So when you put them all together, they sit nicely. And then the retro synth here. I don't know what that's doing. That's just a Logic synth. It's actually the ESP. We've got the ESP in this tune, Howard. Your favorite.
Best synth in the UK.
In the UK?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you can't get it anywhere else. Oh, that's doing the whack thing. Yeah, cool. And that has got some pretty fun automation in the breakdown as well. Lots of delay. You know, that kind of thing. Poly 6 is doing similar stuff. And then we've actually got the same sound that we used in Energy, that little vibrato sine wave thing.
People in the chat have been asking about that.
Yeah. I don't know what we were thinking about that. I don't think it was a conscious thing, was it? Like... to put that in.
We've used it in other tunes as well. They just haven't come out. It's just one of those ones that when we need one, that's the one we go for.
I think for me, it was like, let's just put it in as many tunes as possible. And then like which ones get used for the album will still be based on obviously what's the best tune. But then hopefully that some of them will have that cohesion. Because like we've always said, it's very hard for us to make a cohesive record because we work with a different singer on every song. So I think I had the thought of like, if just a few key noises and key instruments in every song will help with that. Like you know, the Poly Six is on almost every song on this album, and a few others that you guys have seen. But that little noise, I was like, oh, that's cool. And it's on the title track. So put it on the start and the title track brings a nice kind of like cohesion to the whole thing. So yeah, and it's just a fun noise. I totally nicked it off Pearson Sound. That's like completely his thing.
Oh yeah. There's that track called WAD or something.
It's either WAD or Pulsin, P-L-S-N, yeah. Off that EP anyway on Hassle Audio.
It's WAD.
It's such a banger. I think it's on loads of them. But yeah, it's kind of like a dub siren-y type thing, but yeah, I love that sound. So little ode to old UK dubstep. Turn like early or late thousands there, I guess, kind of. That's definitely the inspiration for that little noise. And then we just got some string notes, nice like held string note going on there. And then the post-chorus, bit more movement. There you go. It's not the same note. No, it's just the same preset and sound. Yeah, I don't think Energy and this are in the same key, but it is the same like modulation and all that sort of thing. That is all the harmony. I didn't take long. So yeah, here you go. Here's the bass, drums, pads all together. Yeah, I think we knew once that rolled around for the first time, we were like, yeah, this is banging. Any questions you want to go through, Howard, before we get onto vocals?
Yes, I'd like to know more about your synth bus processing, please. It's on behalf of someone who asked, but I am vaguely interested as well.
It looks to me like that and that.
That's pretty simple.
Does that answer your question? Yeah, it's a little bit of low mids. Dynamic EQ low mids, so that's kind of multi-band compressing the low mids. So that's probably because each synth on its own sounds good, but probably when two or three play at the same time, it's just creating a bit of a boost in the low mids. So that's dealing with that. I mean, it's barely doing anything. Yeah, just it's more there for safety than anything, in case anything jumps out. And then the clean tube setting on Saturn, just to glue them all together and to get them all going through something. I use Saturn a lot as if it was like I was running it through an analog piece of gear. It's not adding tons, but it's the fact that it's summing all the audio together and bringing it together and it's interacting. You know, that's the kind of stuff that you miss using a DAW as opposed to using tape or a desk, you know, a mixing desk. Because at some point down the road, everything goes through the same transistors, the same wires, the same cables. And you lose that with DAW unless you do stuff like this, you know, compress things together, saturate things together, make them interact, you know. That's something I've learned much further down the road in my producing life. But yeah, there you go. That's all that's happening with the pad bus. The bass bus has got a lot more going on, like with the bit crushers, two of those, two Saturns instead of one. We've got a tape one and an amp one, like we showed you earlier. So, but yeah, my bus processing is pretty similar for all my songs. That's a pretty go-to setup for my pad bus, you know. I wouldn't have too much on there usually. I do a lot of effects on each synth before they get there. You know, delay, reverb, overdrive, panning, tremolo, yeah, whatever. The drum bus is usually the most, how would you say, it adds the most character. My drum bus, you know, really changes up the sound. So here's my drum bus here. If I mute all of those plugins. And then put them back in. Whew. Night and day. That's just adding so much character. And that's all just kind of industry standard stuff. Compression, tape, this beautiful Oxford inflator, which I rave on about all the time. Saturn again, some EQ and some limiting. So, you know, and it's all very subtle moves, guys. At the end of the day, you know, if you're choosing bad sounds, no amount of bus processing is going to make it sound good. You got to just have a sick beat there in the first place. Get your sounds right, get the groove right. You know, all of those things there, that adds 10% at the end, you know, it just polishes it all off. Get the idea right first. Just go to vocals now then, get on that?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, cool. So yeah, these were recorded at Capitol Studios in LA. I believe for the verse and the chorus, so all of the like super clean, dry stuff, we recorded using an M49, a Neumann M49, which is...
Good number.
I mean, it's our favorite mic for so many reasons. It's Howard's favorite number. He has it tattooed on him, which I learned last stream. and so did Mum. The vocals recorded for an M49 going through a Neve 1073 preamp because we were in a room that had a whole desk of 1073s, which was amazing. You don't see that very much. So using the desk preamp and a bit of EQ and then a Tube Tech, I would have thought. Most likely a Tube Tech. Straight
this is into Pro Tools, yeah.
Was it? I can't remember. Did Ira do this or was it me?
I think Ira did it and then we transferred it over after.
Yeah. Makes sense. So yeah, it's been in Pro Tools. I've put it through a tiny bit of Melodyne as well, I think, just to touch it up. Yeah, you can see here. So the muted ones are like the befores. Yeah, there's Melodyne there. But you know, Kelis is dope. Nothing drastic needed. If anything, I was probably doing timing in Melodyne. I was probably like aligning things as well because I quite like... I don't love the algorithms in Logic for warping audio. It does affect the quality, whereas Melodyne is pretty good for moving things around. So that was probably more what I was doing in there. A lot of plugins on this bus. So I'll give you a blast of it before with all the plugins, and then I'll give you completely blank after. So here's what it is now.
I've been working and I spent my time dreaming about how I could ease my mind. Break me. Dance feels like I can fly.
Sick. So up front, loads of compression. You know, probably sounds a bit over compressed on its own, but in with all those breakbeat slamming drums, just wanted her to be like really up front. And we thought, you know, this was going to be a single, this song, always. So it's going to be on the radio and, you know, you need your vocal right up front for all those things. So yeah, that was my aim for that. Make sure she was standing out nicely. Here goes all the plugins.
I've been working and I spent my time dreaming about how I could ease my mind.
So it's still a great recording, you know. There's a lot of rumble in there, a lot more like boominess. You've also got, you can hear like the AC in the room. You can hear like the air conditioning, I think, just going along in the back. So I don't mind stuff like that nowadays, to be honest, because software is so clean and, you know, there's no noise and crackle and hiss anymore, ever, that when you record vocals, kind of sometimes that stuff adds that back in. So, you know, I'm not really fussy about traffic and stuff going by outside or air conditioning. I think it just, that was what you captured on the day. That was the vibe. So be it. Let's just take one of her vocals then, this one, which is slightly panned to the left. Going into a Tube Tech again. So it's like the second Tube Tech, if you like.
Dreaming about how I could ease my mind. Breakbeat, dance, feel.
Just, yeah, lightly 3 dB of compression, nothing too crazy. And then I've got this Surfer EQ on it, which I absolutely love. Check out what this thing does.
Dreaming about how I could ease my mind. Breakbeat, dance, feels like I can fly.
That is so clever. It's moving with the lowest note in her voice, in the root note of her voice. So instead of having to duck out like 5 different notches, you just do one and it moves around with it. So clever, man.
Dreaming about how I could ease my mind. Breakbeat, dance, feels like I can fly.
Seriously useful, that plugin. Yeah, I love it for vocals, for, you know, if you want to just change the tone of a vocal, not have to put big slopes and scoops in. Surfer EQ too is the one. Then we are doing some regular EQ. Just taking out a resonance here that I didn't like.
Dreaming about...
that thing.
Breakbeat, dance.
I thought about boosting the highs here, but I've ended up bypassing it, probably because I had some highs on the desk already, so that's all good.
Dreaming about how
again, taking out more low mids. Just didn't need it. Once you got two vocals in there, the low mids double up immediately, so took some out. Gem dopamine, giving some highs. Not much, just a little bit.
Dreaming about how I could ease my mind.
Just a little splash. Then with de-essing, because those S's are a little bit prominent.
Dreaming about how I could ease my mind. Breakbeat, dance, feels like...
There's that. Saturn as well. What we got here? Clean tube. Bit of tube.
Dreaming about how I could ease my mind. Breakbeat, dance, feels like...
So you can only hear it when I really pump it, but it is doing stuff. That is the channel... plugins done, and then we got a hell of a lot of bus plugins. Any questions, Howard?
Yeah, I guess the only thing to say about this bit of vocal is that I can't stop writing vocals with that rhythm at the start, like the on the off of one. Bum, bum. I just, everything I write comes out like that, and I have to then change it from that. And occasionally one gets through like this. Like,
why?
It's actually
why is
in,
that?
It's in You and Me. I don't know. It's just, it seems to just come out. I like it a lot when it lands on beat two. It's in that ad lib at the end that I insisted Eliza did, which is the on, like, yeah, it's about to fade out. I love that river, man. I can't stop putting it in songs. I'm gonna have to see someone about it.
Yeah, you get like a cool polyrhythm if you keep
yeah,
saying
it's just
it.
A cool little thing. I like doing it.
Okay, cool. Any like lyrical content you want to explain or anything about this verse?
Not really. Like, it's kind of what we said earlier with Kelis. It's just about like trying to capture the vibe of being in one of those old clubs, and getting down, getting into the moment of it in a club. It's such a cliche thing to write about, but it just felt right at the time when we were listening to this beat. We were like, it has to be about that. We can't write about anything else.
Yeah, well, that's why the word breakbeat.
Mine, breakbeat, dance.
That was like probably the first word we wrote, right? Because we were like, mm-hmm, breakbeat. Mm-hmm. So that's how that got there. All right, cool. So I'll put these both back on. So now you're hearing both the vocals with no bus processing.
Mine, breakbeat, dance, feels like I can.
So those are both getting compressed again by LA76.
Mine, breakbeat, dance, feels like.
Turn it on.
Breakbeat, dance, feels like I can fly.
Super low, it's just catching the very, like, highest of peaks. Decapitator is next. That is going to be adding some distortion.
Mine, breakbeat, dance, feels like I can fly.
So I'm actually pumping that really hard, but I've only got it on about 20%. And that's just to add some grit underneath the vocals, some like radio lo-fi frequencies, which we'll get to later. But the post-chorus of the song is like really lo-fi and really distorted. So I just was trying to kind of get the listener ready for that. You know, I didn't want to just go totally clean, totally distorted. This is like a halfway house between both.
Mine, breakbeat, dance, feels like I can fly.
Love that. Some more EQ, getting rid of some more resonance.
Mine, dance, feels like I can fly.
Minor stuff here. There's like 1 or 2 dB. Yeah, nothing really.
Mine, breakbeat, dance, feels like.
A bit more de-essing going on up here. Then we're going inflator and then some more de-essing.
Mine, breakbeat, dance, feels like I can fly. Give me some space so I can close.
You know, these are all really subtle moves, guys. Look, 2-3 dB on the de-esser. You know, this is giving 2-3 dB of inflator. I love layering plugins. So it's, you know, every little piece is doing something important at a low level. And when you add it all up, the difference is huge. Then we got soothe.
Mine, breakbeat, dance, feels like.
See how it just caught that on beat, breakbeat.
Mine, breakbeat, dance, feels.
So good, man.
Mine, breakbeat, dance.
Up there, it's just gone.
Mine, breakbeat, dance, feels.
So good. And then delay. Reverb effects, basically.
Mine, breakbeat.
Got some automation on this Echo Boy. It's kind of filling in the gaps in between her where she stops singing. So you can see that wet and dry knob just move.
I've been working and I spent my time dreaming about how I could ease my mind. Breakbeat, dance, feels like I can fly. Give me.
Yeah, so that's doing that. Bit of reverb.
I've been working and I spent my time dreaming about how I.
And then like a super short kind of slapback delay for the.
I've been working and I spent my time.
Just again, adding
my
to that
kind of slapback.
Yeah, that's Howard's favorite thing, is to put like an 80s short delay on every vocal ever. And then we got, wow, quite a lot of EQ there. I'm surprised that's there. I probably wouldn't do this anymore. I probably wouldn't have that. I don't think it's needed. I'd probably leave it there.
I've been working and I spent my time dreaming about how I could ease my mind.
Yeah, it's just, again, making it sound a little bit more talk, like a small radio speaker vibe. But yeah, I'd probably leave that off now if I was doing it again. Just taking out more resonance. And then these things here are all just reverbs, delays, like slightly more subtle reverbs and delays. And then sidechain, quite heavy sidechain on this, because it's really thumping tune with the kick drum.
I've been working and.
Here we go. Because I'm on Zoom at the same time, we're going to get into problems now.
And my time, dreaming about how I could ease my mind.
There you go, you get it. That's the lead vocal in both verses. There's a few BVs here. Dance, where she says dance. We just kind of layered that up. We thought it would sound cool.
Breakbeat, dance, feels like I can.
Yeah, she's just saying the word dance.
Dance.
That was one thing, wasn't it, Howard, that we were certain we wanted to get Kelis talking on this tune, not
yeah.
just singing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because she's got such a cool talking voice. Like, the stuff she does in Millionaire is like some of her best sounding stuff.
Yeah, that's kind of half talking, half singing.
Yeah, she does a bit of talking where it's like, da 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 da, you know, it's yeah. kind of
halfway
talking
between.
In tune. Yeah.
Yeah, but her tone is, yeah, so raspy, like so much mm-hmm. flavor in there. It's great. Here's the chorus. I'm not going to go through all the plugins because they're basically the same. The bus is almost the same. It's just wider. It's got more parts to it, more panning. There's some whispers in there as well. Don't look in the crowd, baby. Even when the lights come down, I like to dance like I'm alone in the room. I'm here tonight, baby, to do what I do, yeah. There you go. That's the vocal. And we've got those whispers there. Panned right, left and right. Oh, look at this, Howard. Panned to 49 left and right. I wonder why.
Yes. Yes. That will have been my doing.
It's the correct amount, as you would say. Yeah. And there's a low octave in there as well. But I think that's just a little altar boy doing that. Is there a little altar boy here? Oh, yeah. There you go. Sending to bus 9. I don't look in the crowd, baby, even when the lights come. So, you know, sounds a bit shitty on its own, but in the mix, just fills that space nicely. I don't look in the crowd, baby, even when the lights come down. I like to dance like a... You know, it's a good quick fix if you don't want to spend another 45 minutes doing lows. I didn't think it really needed it as well, because there's such a big bass line in this song. That frequency like is full enough, so just kept it simple. BVs, are they there? Even when the lights come down. Even when the lights come down. Yeah, so it's just one harmony in this song. You must have had to really hold back on that, Howard.
You know, I was feeling restrained. I was like, I'm going to do one chord and one harm and just make them both really good.
That is a good philosophy. All right, let me move these up so you guys can see. This is my favorite part of the song, the post-chorus. Howard, do you want to tell the people a little bit of why this is so special, this post-chorus?
Wait, what?
Well, it's how we recorded it.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I see. We decided we wanted to make Kelis's vocals sound like it was coming through like a megaphone or something. We just wanted it to be like dirty. So we asked Ira, our engineer at Capitol Studios. Capitol Studios is a sick place, by the way. It's where like Frank Sinatra and loads of amazing people have recorded historically. And so we were like, what's the worst microphone you've got in the building? They were like, what, the worst one? We were like, yeah, the worst possible one. And he like went out and asked around, and he came back with this thing that was like, it's about like, I don't know, probably the size of like a mouse for a computer or something like that. And just had a wire going into it. There's no stand. You had to just hold it. And it's for a harmonica, right? Is that what it was for, guy?
Yeah, harmonica mic. I'm just going to try and find it actually. But it looked like the end of a golf club.
Yeah, that's it. It's like that kind of look.
Here it is. Okay. And it's the Shure it's like 520. The Shure 520 DX. You see it?
Yeah, that's the one. That's the one.
It's got a gain knob on the bottom, so it's got a preamp in it. And yeah, that's it. So it's made for harmonica. I don't know why it would be specifically for harmonica. I guess because it literally captures like no low mids at all and no super highs.
Horrible, horrible sounding microphone. And so we used it for Kelis.
Yeah, so we used it on Kelis. Yeah, but she was laughing her head off because we were saying that all that stuff in front of her, just being like, hey, can you get the worst mic? And she'd be like, sorry, what? Can I not use Frank Sinatra's mic? Like, no, you should use this mic. But she was fine with. So yeah, that is that's how we managed to achieve this sound, or at least how we started achieving it. So there's a lot of processing on it still, but it was a good base level to begin. I will bypass everything. Here it is.
You make me watch a step when you move.
So my favorite thing about it is the plosives on the P's. That's where you can hear it like breaking up.
You make me watch a step when you move.
Just sounds like she's talking for a walkie-talkie, basically. That was the general vibe.
Make me watch a step when you move.
So yeah, you can hear all that distortion.
You can hear her stomping her foot as well, I think.
So this was recorded just right in front of the speakers. We didn't even put her in the vocal booth. She was just...
Oh, like, that's right. Yeah, that's what we're hearing.
Yeah. So you're hearing probably the kick drum coming through.
You make me watch a step when you move.
Sounds
now
so
what you're doing is making me move with you.
So yeah, there's...
Sounds kind of demonic.
Yeah, it just sounds lo-fi, crushed up. So yeah, on each track, I've taken out some rumble. Not that there really is any. I'm compressing them probably hard.
You make me watch a step when you move.
No, not that hard. Fair enough. And then overdrive, lots of overdrive.
You make me watch a step when you move.
And then a bit of de-essing.
You make me watch a step when you move.
And then we're really getting into the lo-fi vibes. So this is where Decapitator's really taking the lead.
You make me watch a step when you move. Now what you're doing is making me move with you.
Extra crackle, extra distortion, then more compression.
You make me watch a step when you move.
Now we're really getting to the forefront of it.
You make me watch a step when you move.
Now probably some pretty brutal EQ. Yeah, this is what's really making it sound lo-fi.
You make me watch a step when you move.
So for me, boosting anything around 1K always makes things sound like a little old radio. So that's being boosted.
Now what you're doing is making me move.
And I'm just boosting all those nice distorted, crackly imperfections up here.
Now what you're doing is making me move.
That's going into inflator.
You make me watch a step when you move.
Really distorting the inflator as well.
You make me watch a step when you move.
De-esser and soothe.
Now what you're doing is making me move with you.
Soothe's doing a lot, actually, here.
You make me watch a step when you move.
Really helping it not sound too, like, ouch. couple of delays, and then it's reverb, and then what's that? Bit crusher.
You make me watch a step when you move.
Finishing off the demonic vibe with a bit
you
crusher.
You make me watch a step.
And then is there more EQ? Wow, even more EQ. Yeah, I absolutely mangled this one.
You make me watch a step when you move.
Now we're fully in 1940s gramophone territory, which is what I wanted.
You make me watch a step when you move.
So there you go. That's how we did it.